Welcome to Platform Media International Political Arena. This is Joe Ehizode. Tonight, we're talking about the current issue that Africans are at war in South Africa. As you all must have known, South Africans are telling Africans to get out from their country. And the name given to that is xenophobia or Afrophobia. Well, it is not the name that matters now, it is the activity of South Africans against Africans. With me in the studio tonight is my very good friend Obi Nzadibe. Welcome to the program.
Thank you, Joe. Thank
Obi,
you
for having I'm happy me. To see you again. I have to apologize to my viewers because all through the summer I was away and we didn't, we staffed them of Political Arena. I'm happy to see you again.
Thank you.
And let's give them the stuff, let's keep going because there's no time to waste.
Thank
Welcome.
You.
The South Africans of late has been very restive about fellow Africans who are residing in South Africa. They are telling them to go. As a matter of fact, a plane load of Nigerians arrived this evening in Lagos with about 314 unwilling Nigerians coming back home. And as a result of the killing and looting of Nigerian businesses and property in South Africa. Obi, you remember, you recall, let's refresh our viewers with this. In 1972, Ghana asked Nigerians to go. And in 1981, the famous Ghana must go in Nigeria. Nigeria retaliated and asked Ghanaians to leave Nigeria. In all of this, if you recall, has he ever helped the country who perpetrated this in their economy or political affairs, telling their foreign brothers or their brothers to leave their country?
It has never helped. It's a wrong approach to the development of an economy. It hasn't helped. It's not the right thing to do. Nigeria was wrong to ask Ghanaians to leave. Ghanaians were wrong to have asked Nigerians to leave in 1969 and in 1972. And South Africans are wrong too to ask foreigners to leave.
Well, Obi, the painful aspect of it as a Nigerian, as Nigerians, we will say, is an irony. Because growing up in Nigeria, and I attended Abafemi Awolowo University, we had the core number of South Africans who were on scholarship in our university. So it was in the University of Lagos, all over universities, some of the universities in southern part of Nigeria, where South Africans were granted scholarship to train in Nigeria in preparation for freedom. And as a matter of fact, Nigeria was one of the four, what you call, frontline states.
Yes.
I remember Abraham Odia, who was Supreme Council of Sports in Nigeria, stood against South Africa, made it possible that South Africa was banned from international
competitions.
Barely 30 years all this happened. The same South Africa are telling their brothers to go. Is it a case of biting the figures that fed them or a case of being ungrateful?
I have been looking at these things very deeply. Like I said before, what South Africans did cannot be excused. But again, the fault is not that of South Africans alone. All of Africa stands to be blamed. If you were helping your brother who was in bondage, there is no need for you to swarm him, for every African nation to go take refuge in South Africa. At the time you were helping your brother, you should also be helping yourself. If we offered scholarships to South Africans in the 70s, we should have developed our economy so much so that our people are not rushing out of our country to seek for better pastures in South Africa. So what happened recently is a call for deeper reflection on African governments. You know, I believe that Nigeria has failed her citizens. you know, Nigerian citizens are in a hurry to leave Nigeria. Nigerians who were being mistreated in Libya a couple of years ago, they were being sold as slaves. That should have been a wake-up call to the Nigerian government to take a drastic action to ensure that our people don't try to run away, that we create a conducive environment for them to operate in Nigeria, to be able to live a secured life, to find employment, to be able to do their business, to provide them with the infrastructure they need to survive. So our failure to do those things is pushing these people to go to countries where they are not welcome.
Okay, your thought just took me back. Let's charity begins where the charity begins from home. Let's take a look at what's happening in the home front. Are Nigerian politicians worried? Do you think they are worried by the fact what we saw on television where Nigerians were being burned, they were being kicked around? Are you sure our Nigerians, the politicians, they have a conscience to say these are issues that need to be addressed? Do you think so?
No, they're not bothered. They're not bothered. Until, for me, it's a good thing that Nigerians were forced back from South Africa. Let them put the pressure, because if you don't mount the pressure on the politicians, they won't do anything. We've had democracy since 1999. We cannot boast of stable electricity as at this date. We do not have roads. Our railway system is not functioning. The industries are closing down. There is no security on our roads, and the police continue to be brutal. So what have we gained from this democracy? You know, in other countries of the world, people will gather the politicians and set them ablaze. You know, they have failed to deliver the dividends of democracy to the masses of our people, and that's why they are rushing to South Africa.
One other issue that I wanted also to point out that is, I know both of us, we migrated to Canada a long time ago, but the easy way out for Nigerians to quickly take flight, some people have argued, is the reason why politicians are becoming reckless, because they are not afraid of anything. They are not afraid of riots. They are not afraid of coups anymore, because the soldiers have been completely decimated. So this recklessness among the politicians stems from the fact that there's no extra pressure on them. The labor unions are gone. Students' unions are gone. Even people, the civil disobedience that we used to know that happens in Nigeria is no longer there. So the politician can begin to do whatever they like. Do you agree to that?
No. The organized resistance to bad governance, as it used to be in the past, is no longer there. But there is the resistance by Nigerian people. There is kidnapping. There is militancy. There is Boko Haram. There is armed robbery. You know, it has taken a different form, and is going to continue to increase in intensity until the nation becomes ungovernable, unless serious action is taken. Right now, the Kaduna Abuja Road is not under the control of the government of Nigeria. You know, you can be picked up from that road at any point in time. The kidnappers strike at will. And so Nigerians are resisting, but not doing it using the formal ways they used to do it.
But the resistance is not going to the people that are supposed to go, because the rich people fly.
No. Politicians from Katsina State now cannot move outside Abuja to their homes. To their home states. And it's the same thing in a lot of states.
But they have a choice to stay in Abuja.
They have a choice,
but people don't have the choice.
They don't enjoy staying in Abuja. You know, they cannot travel freely. There is pressure. There is pressure, but it's not in the organized format that we used to know in the past.
Yeah, you just mentioned there is pressure, but there's no adequate response from the government, because I have not seen. The pictures we saw on television, you and I couldn't sleep, because we saw Nigerians being burnt alive or kicked out of their homes in South Africa. Mm. But the government have not responded, what they call rapid response to issues like that. Even it took the head of state a lot of time to make any adequate response.
There's a saying in law that if you want to go to equity, you will go with clean hands. Nigerian government cannot, in good conscience, take action against South Africa, because they were 60% responsible for what happened to their citizens.
So, in the first instance. No, I'm talking about the home front, domestic affairs. The Nigerian government had not responded adequately the way we want to say, let's put in policy in place to address the concerns why Nigerians are fleeing. We don't see that.
They're not, but it's going to take a long time. There's a lot of things that needs to be done. They probably don't have a vision for what needs to be done. But aside from that, aside from the actions of the South Africans, I'm also worried, as a Nigerian, by the conduct of my fellow countrymen when they travel to other people's countries.
That takes also the international scene. You see the allegations that South Africans were laying, that the foreigners, not only Nigerians, come, they take the sell drugs, they engage in nefarious activities. As a matter of fact, one laughable aspect is that they use this way to take over their women, and that is very painful to them. Well, in that case, again, you will argue that Nigerians or the foreigners in South Africa are not justified to do that. But what we are saying is that if you admit people in your country, you should let the law take a full course. What do you think about that?
Well, my thoughts on that,
yes,
is that anyone living in Nigeria, you know, going abroad now has become a thing for the dogs. You know, anyone with money can just go abroad. Days are gone when people left Nigeria specifically for postgraduate studies or for research opportunities.
And then come back home.
And then they went back home after their studies. And so I'm thinking that for Nigeria to allow you to leave Nigeria, we need to set some minimum prerequisites that people would meet. You know, have them undergo some form of training, some form of orientation, because these individuals are going out as our nation's ambassadors. You know, so we don't want our bad eggs.
Who would do that orientation?
Government? The Nigerian government can, you know, I shouldn't suggest this publicly, but let me do. They can introduce an exit visa. You know, for you to qualify for an exit visa, you will undergo some form of orientation.
In a democracy?
In a democracy, yes.
So
many nations in the world have exit visas.
That's a gay human right.
No. So many countries in the world have give you an exit visa that qualifies you to apply for a visa to any other country. But before we give you that exit visa, we'll orient your mind. You know, to be our ambassador wherever you go.
Exit visa is a tough call because your border is porous.
That's not a problem. Mm-hmm. That's not a problem. You can go anywhere you like without an exit visa, but you cannot come back
if
you don't have an exit visa. We will not admit you back. People cannot at will go to tarnish the image of the nation and expect to come back and be welcomed by that same government.
Great.
You know, there needs to be rules. There needs to be an obligation placed on Nigerians traveling abroad to represent us and represent us well.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, what do you have to say about African Union? African Union used to be Organization of African OAU, mm-hmm. African Unity. Mm-hmm. I think it was changed to African Union. Mm-hmm. And when I was in high school, I remember the Secretary General of OAU, Unzo Ekengaki of Cameroon. From there, we used to know these names. But I don't think you and I know the current Secretary General of OAU, African Union. That's to tell you how docile, how stagnant, how non-functional African Union is. On issues like this, we have not had any policy statement from African Union. You think it's something beyond them?
Well, it's not something beyond them. They probably didn't think that these things would happen, so they have no rule on
how. After 59 years.
Yes, on how member nations would treat citizens of other countries. And if they mistreated them, the repercussions that would follow, there's nothing on the plate to deal with this. So nations like South Africa are at liberty to do what they like.
Okay. The last question will be what I want to ask you. Retaliation in form of African countries in Zambia and a land that they are also driving South Africa away from their country. Mm-hmm. In Nigeria, there was a riot targeting South African companies. Is it justifiable?
No, it's wrong.
Anything violent?
No, it's wrong. Several years ago, I was told that when Germany was divided into two, the East and the West, people from the East packed garbage in a truck and threw it across the fence to West Germany. The West Germans gathered cans of food and things that were valuable and sent it back to them. You know, when people mistreat you, you don't stay at their level and act the way they did. You have to show them a higher standard. You know,
when, as well, Obama, Mrs. Obama used to say, when they go low,
yeah, so you aim higher.
Obi, thank you very much. Viewers, we're back again on Political Arena on Platform Media International. Tonight, we looked at xenophobia or Afrophobic activities in South Africa targeting fellow Africans accident to leave. Obi gave it a good thrashing tonight, and perhaps you enjoyed yourself. We usually be here every week. They're giving you a bit-by-bit account and good analysis of issues around the globe. Obi, I want to thank you for coming again.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
All right. Yes, that's Platform Media Political Arena. I'm yours sincerely, Joe Ehizode, signing off and say happy good night rest. Bye-bye.